Hello, my name is John Francis, and I'm a professor of law with Washburn University School of Law in Topeka, Kansas. I teach criminal law, criminal procedure, and I've been a practitioner in the criminal justice system for over three decades. The COVID-19 pandemic presents broad-ranging challenges to the criminal justice system. Proceedings in court, conditions in jails and prisons, and even face-to-face meetings with court services, community corrections, and parole personnel place people in close proximity to each other. Each of these contacts increases the risk of the virus spreading, preventing people from having close contact within the criminal justice system and settings may reduce vectors for spreading COVID-19. But taking steps to reduce in-person contact has an impact on citizens' rights and brings into play issues of justice, liberty, and public safety. Throughout the criminal justice system, we're seeing courts postponing hearings and trials, canceling dockets for certain types of cases, and conducting proceedings via video conference. However, such steps have consequences. They affect filing deadlines in cases, they affect speedy trial rights, and they affect statutes of limitations. When cases get delayed, they don't just disappear. Delays will necessarily create backlogs of cases and crowded dockets down the road when cases in person resume. Conducting some hearings by video conference now may relieve some backlog down the road, but conducting certain types of proceedings by video conference may also affect confrontation rights of the accused. We're also seeing options being considered to reduce the population of correctional facilities, including early release of nonviolent inmates, and methods being explored to reduce the number of new admittees coming into the system. In this brief presentation, I will address steps being taken to address some of these legal issues. So let's first take a look at actions being taken in Kansas regarding court proceedings. On May 16th of this year, the Kansas State Legislature passed House Substitute for Senate Bill 102, which authorizes the Chief Justice of the Kansas Supreme Court during a disaster emergency to issue an order to extend or suspend any court deadlines or time limitations that are established by statute. These types of deadlines include filing deadlines, speedy trial deadlines, and statute of limitations deadlines. Now, certain conditions must exist for the Chief Justice to issue an order under this new legislation, and those conditions are a declared state of disaster emergency pursuant to KSA 48-924. In addition, the Chief Justice must determine that action is necessary to secure health and safety of court users, staff, and judicial officers. And that, of course, will be the action that is contemplated in any order that the Chief Justice issues. An order issued by the Chief Justice under the statute may remain in effect for up to 150 days after the state of emergency has been terminated. Now, because cases that are delayed pursuant to this order don't disappear, under SB 102 or House Substitute for SB 102, any trial scheduled to occur during the time such order was in effect shall be placed back on docket within 150 days of the termination of the declared emergency. So that's the legal framework that we're looking at. Now let's take a look at events that have occurred to implement those provisions. On March 12th of this year, Kansas Governor Laura Kelly declared a state of disaster emergency, warranting extraordinary measures to mitigate the spread of COVID-19. On March 18, under the authority of House Replacement for Senate Bill 102, Chief Justice Lukert issued Administrative Order 2020-PR-016. The Chief Justice's order notes that escalation of the emergency requires that she implement measures to protect the health and safety of Kansans, including people who interact in our court system, and that includes judicial branch employees and judges, and of course people who use the judicial branch, like litigants. Finding that the following steps are necessary to secure the health and safety of court users and staff and judicial officers, the Chief Justice ordered the following occur. All criminal and civil jury trials scheduled to begin after March 18th are continued until further notice, or until further order, rather, of the Chief Justice. Trials that were in progress on the day of the order were to continue to their conclusion, and people involved in those trials were encouraged to follow CDC and KDHE guidance on steps to reduce the spread of COVID-19. Deadlines and time limitations to bring criminal defendants to trial under statutory speedy trial provisions are suspended until further order of the Chief Justice. Now, of course, if there are constitutional speedy trial issues that come into being later on, that might be something that gets litigated down the road. Kansas District and Appellate Courts, clerks and court services officers are restricted to emergency operations until further order by the Chief Justice. So then that raises the question, what are emergency operations? Well, under the order, emergency operations include determining probable cause within 48 hours of a person being arrested for that person, or rather for persons who are arrested without a warrant, conducting first appearances in criminal cases, setting appearance bonds and conditions of release, and issuing warrants. And the types of warrants that are being contemplated for that include arrest warrants, search warrants, and warrants for violation of probation and supervised release. To the extent feasible, emergency operations must be conducted by electronic audio-visual communications. And of course, that has to be consistent with rights granted under the United States Constitution and the Kansas Constitution. Whether or not video conference proceedings in certain types of proceedings is compliant with constitutional provisions may be something that gets litigated down the road in courts. Other provisions of the Chief Justice's order are designed to reduce the number of in-person contacts, and that includes suspending DNA collection, urinalysis testing, alcohol testing, and home visits performed by judicial branch employees. Probationers who had previously been ordered to report to their probation officers in person are now to report by telephone. And all statutes of limitations and statutory time standards or deadlines are suspended until further order by the Chief Justice. No criminal action is going to be dismissed for lack of prosecution during the time of this order. Let's turn now to actions that are being taken in the federal courts, specifically the United States District Court for the District of Kansas. On March 30th, Chief Judge Robinson issued Administrative Order 2020-4, and that order states that the Judicial Conference of the United States has found that under the CARES Act, which was passed by Congress under H.R. 748, that emergency conditions due to the national emergency that was declared by the president will materially affect operations and functioning of the federal courts generally, and specifically within this district of Kansas. The district court recognizes the need to assist in the preservation of public safety and health, while at the same time effectively administering justice during this period of national emergency. So with these findings, the court is authorizing use of video teleconferencing or telephone in criminal proceedings enumerated under the CARES Act. And that includes using video teleconferencing for detention hearings, initial appearances, preliminary hearings, waiver of indictment, arraignment, probation revocation proceedings, pretrial release revocation proceedings, and proceedings that are related to arrests for violating conditions of release in another district. Let's turn now to the impact of COVID-19 on jails and prisons. Officials are concerned with the potentially catastrophic consequences of the virus getting into one of the facilities and the closed environments that we have in those facilities. Reducing the number of new admissions, releasing nonviolent, medically compromised prisoners, and limiting the number of visitors to correctional facilities are all protective steps being explored and implemented at facilities across the country. Let's turn first to limiting new admittances and how that's being achieved. There are different approaches being taken in different places in the country. For example, in Philadelphia, police have been directed to stop making arrests for low-level offenses, which include low-level drug charges. The idea is that by reducing arrests, that will reduce the number of new admittances into a jail. Another example of steps being taken is in California, where the California governor has issued an order that suspends intake and transfer of adults and juveniles into the state correctional facilities. And that might be transfers from jails or new admissions from sentences. Another step being implemented in different locations is to limit imposition of jail sanctions on people who are on parole and probation and are committing only technical violations of their parole or probation violations. Let's take a look at steps that have been reported locally in the Topeka Capital Journal to protect prison and jail populations. Officials at the Shawnee County Jail have reported to the Capital Journal that, first of all, inmates sharing cells and sometimes even sharing bunks demonstrate that a jail is not built for social distancing. And the officials note that the biggest risk or the biggest concern that they have is the virus entering a facility through new inmates. According to the Capital Journal, the CEO of the company that holds the healthcare contract for Kansas Department of Corrections has warned that inmates are an extremely vulnerable population, and that one infected patient can affect the entire facility. So to mitigate the risk of viruses of the COVID-19 virus getting into a facility, steps are being taken to reduce inmate populations. Once again, the Capital Journal reports that defense attorneys, the Shawnee County District Attorney, and the courts are reviewing bond conditions of inmates who are currently being held, and they're looking specifically at people who are in custody for non-violent offenses. And they're looking to amend the terms of bond to make bond more achievable for these non-violent offenders. There's also a coalition of Kansas attorneys who are urging the governor to consider releasing medically fragile people and elderly inmates who have less than 6 months left on their sentences. And the idea is that releasing these medically fragile people will help reduce some of the potential medical stress in the facilities. There are also reports that releasing people who are in custody solely for technical violations of parole or probation is another step that's being considered. Systemic responses to the COVID-19 pandemic are developing rapidly. Between the time of making this recording and the time that this recording is posted, there will undoubtedly be new developments. I've attempted to address a few of the issues that come up by taking such steps to reduce the spread of COVID-19 within the criminal justice system. It's likely that some implemented remedies that affect constitutional rights will be tested later on in the courts. I hope you found this presentation informative. Be well.